4 days, we saw discipleship as a spiritual journey, mostly restricted to the 12 disciples of Jesus. By going through this whole program consistently, mostly with the Gospel of Mark. If there is one person who can be called a disciple par excellence, the most excellent disciple, it was none other than Mary, our mother, mother of Jesus. She was mother as well as the disciple of Jesus. Notice, she was the mother of Jesus. At the same time, she was also a disciple of Jesus. She followed her journey of life in the Word of God in deep faith. That's why we call her a disciple par excellence. I've got 7 stages in this journey. 7 stages. Stage 1 is the way she accepts the call to be mother and disciple of Jesus. Stage 2, how her immediate response to being called disciple is to help a person in need. She goes through Elizabeth to help her. And the 3rd stage is the birth of Jesus, where she played an excellent role as a mother of a child and also a disciple of that same child. And the 4th stage is her response to the infancy of Jesus in deep contemplation. There is a contemplative dimension in the discipleship. The 5th stage is how she gets involved in the mission of Jesus. The miracle in Cana of Galilee is her own involvement in the ministry of Jesus. And the 6th stage is her affinity with the church. And the 7th stage is her affinity with the world. She is a disciple. Her discipleship has the whole humanity with her. So these are the 7 stages. I have to go through the 4 stages in this 1 session and the 2nd 3 stages in the afternoon session. So my friends, as Mary was living with Jesus Christ those 3 years, she was following him, though may not be closely going about with him. She lived around somewhere. She must have seen the struggles of the 12 disciples, their joys and their anxieties, their sorrows, their concerns. So, Jesus did not formally treat her as a disciple. She was his mother. But her whole attitude toward Jesus was as a disciple. It was the total commitment to Jesus in deep faith and in the Word of God that is part of this theme on as Mary as a disciple par excellence. 1st stage, the call of Mary in generates a discipleship. See the way the evangelist Luke describes the call of Mary. He summarized what we call a call narrative. A call narrative. We see several people in the Bible called in a similar fashion. First of all, there is an encounter between God and the person called. And there is the desire of God mentioned toward the person, purpose for the call, and the mission for the person. And the person never accepts immediately. There is always doubt and anxiety in the call. Then the Lord tries to explain, clear the doubt, give assurance, of the feats of saints. And what will be the last stage? There is a total acceptance of the call. And once the call is accepted, it is sincerely followed. This is an example in the Old Testament, Moses' call. God meets him on Mount Horeb. He tells him the purpose he has in mind for him. He expresses an ability. He goes through several issues saying that I can't do this, I can't do that. But the Lord assures, don't worry, I will see to you, I will send someone with you. So he gives him certain signs. Finally, he accepts and goes for a difficult mission on liberating people from Egypt. Similarly, also we have other calls like the call of Isaiah, call of Jeremiah, call of Paul himself. So they are all in the same line. We call them call narratives, call stories, where they want the beautiful principle, how the word of God entices the person called, how the person becomes a disciple of the one who calls him. In our case, it is Mary, and the one person who calls him is God himself for the sake of his own son, Jesus Christ. What do we have here? Mary, a quiet young lady, seated somewhere in a small house in Nazareth. Definitely, she was just an ordinary woman in a family. Maybe her parents were still alive, and were not alive, we don't know. Nothing is said about that. Anyway, she's there. And there is, first of all, an encounter with God and the young woman through the angel. The call starts with an encounter with God and the human person. So she startled that a young man is trying to speak to her. Angel comes in the form of a human person. And he addresses her, full of grace. Something is there happening to you. God is going to give you something. You are blessed. And he goes on to tell her the purpose for his call. Namely, she has become the mother of Jesus who is to be born. Messiah will be born, and she will be the mother of the Messiah. She will have to bear him in her womb. So, encounter is there. The call has come. And she needs to be agitated. How can this be? The main objection is, I am a virgin. I am not married. She was only betrothed to Joseph. They never came together. I am only a virgin. The angel tries to assure her, the Holy Spirit come upon you, the power of the Most High will overshadow you. That which is born will be the Son of God, the Most High. Don't you worry, God will do everything for you. Then even now she is not easily able to understand all these things. Then the angel gives her a sign, he said, assure her, gives her a sign, your cousin Elizabeth, she has been called, not able to bear a child. Barren, she is already with a child. That sign was a very, very visible, tangible sign. Yes, Elizabeth, my cousin, she is old, she is more than 90 years of age, and she is going to have a child. That was a good sign. And with that, she accepts. And her word is, let it be done to me according to your word. So the journey of faith has begun. A long and very, very, very important journey where she has accepted God's call, where she has accepted to be the mother of the incarnate Son with her total surrender. Let it be done to me according to your word. In Latin, this expresses in one word, fiat. Let it be. So, my dear fathers, that her fiat required a lot of courage on her part. Her acceptance of God's call did indeed require to muster a lot of energy from her. of sworn call, angel came and told her, and yet the society has come in its own way of looking at people. And again, it's a very woman. She's pregnant. She's not married. She's the purple Joseph poor man. And they have not come together. And again, she's with a child. Of course, the same story that go to Matthew's Gospel. In fact, the angel appears to Joseph. Your wife is in a child. Don't you worry. It is all from the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, a good man, accepts. But the society won't accept. He himself was thinking to put her away so that people should not speak badly about her. She's a good woman. And yet, the Lord tells him, it is the power of the Holy Spirit, he accepts her. And he accepted her. But the world will not notice. And actually, the journey again begins with total acceptance, total surrender, in spite of the fact it's going to cause a lot of disturbance in the society around. People talk ill of her, people talk ill of them. So many fathers, the call begins with a real purpose in life. She's going to begin a journey in spite of what is going to happen. See, the disciples were called also. Jesus told them, make fishers of men. It was a wonderful project. They didn't understand what's all going to be. When Peter was called, as the Luke's Gospel, he said, Lord, I am a sinner, get away from me. I am not worthy of this sort of a thing. I was all, what will you make a job? You need to be fishing men. The doubts came only, what exactly is going to be their role that Jesus was going wrong and his hope of distraction. Then only they began to question why he was suffering and death. So many fathers, any call towards the life of commitment does need courage, does need real confidence. We have to face a lot of difficulties, oppositions. So that is the meaning of God's call. We have got human calls. People may call us, okay, I want to meet you. Please come and see me. That's an ordinary human call. Maybe the governor or even that may be a little more difficult for us to have a call with the governor or the minister. But suppose the local MP or MLA like to meet for so and so, then we go to a normal call and so on. But here we have a call from God Himself, and may we accept this call with total surrender. So all of us have this call, thus we are called to become priests or become disciples. We accepted the call and we have accepted the call. And we also, this call, accepted call is not easy to materialize, easy to function. So it will be difficulties, we have these difficulties, but we accepted the call. So that is the first stage of discipleship, called by God, accepting this call from God. What happens to her immediately after the call? She had listened to God's word to the angel. What are the signs given to the meaningfulness of this call has been our own cousin Elizabeth in her old age is to conceive. And that was a message for her. And immediately she would like to go and meet her cousin. She could have said, well, I know the mother of God. Why should I go? People should come and see me. I have the what is great honor of being the mother of the incarnate son. Why should I go? No. She left aside all such ideas of self-honor, self-dignity. She would like to go and visit Elizabeth. It is not very near. She lives in Judea. Almost 300 kilometers from Nazareth, in a village called Angry. I went to the village a couple of times, a little high hill, we would walk up there. Even today, there is a beautiful church there, and there is the Magnificat. My soul magnifies the Lord, written in about 100 languages. The walls of the church is also written in Tamil, written in Malayalam, written in Telugu, Sanskrit and so on. So that place is the place where she is going to do her first act of service. The service comes as a result of her own call. So the first effect of the call has been that she should be at the disposal of the needy, at the disposal of the human beings. My father, even Jesus Christ, the moment he began to be available to people, the first thing was he gave a manifesto of his mission. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, or something like this, to open the eyes of the blind, to set free the captives. So it means his call from the Father to be the incarnate Son. The purpose for which he is sent to the world is for the service of the needy. So Mary also, the first expression of her acceptance of the call by God to be the mother of Jesus, was to serve people, to be at the disposal of people. So that's why when he goes there, he meets the Blessed Elizabeth, and she bursts out, "My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. As it's down upon this handmaid, God has given me a great honor by choosing me. God has given me a new dimension of life in my name, in my situation. I'm an ordinary person, and then God has chosen me." So she makes a big issue about her choice being made mother of Jesus Christ. "And I come here to be with you, to serve you." And in the course of this Manjika, he also says, you know, he has put down the mighty from the thrones and exalted those of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. She almost gives a pre-evangelization what Jesus was to do later on, what Jesus was to speak later on. He gives a message prior to that. He has put down the mighty, exalted the lowly, the focus of the day. So, my fathers, this message of liberation, message of real praise of God, is already an echo of what happened in the Old Testament. When Anna, the mother of Samuel, was also a barren woman, of repeated prayer, God has made her mother of a child, an example, and has taken a child, and she also sings a similar thing to God, exalting God, making God really something part of her life, because she has looked upon this lowly servant, lowly woman. She has been all the time scolded by people that she was a barren woman, she has no child and so on. So, God has her. So, this stage of Mary is a stage of service, stage where she becomes part of another woman's life. She spent some time until the child is born. So, she was a servant of another woman. A maidservant of God became a servant of another woman because she was in need. So, my fathers, the journey of discipleship, the service actually becomes a vital element. It's not the first time. She'll be serving people later on, every stage. But already, before even this was born, she expressed a spirit of total commitment to the service of the needy. And she went to Elizabeth and began to be with her. Mary's visit to the needy, Blessed Elizabeth to Judea, is an expression of a journey of faith. With a significant call from God. A significant expression of our faith in God. God is there, God called me, God has asked me to do this, and I will take upon myself the responsibility of seeing to the well-being of my own cousin who is in need. She needs my help now, so she goes there. So that is the second stage of her discipleship. A journey of faith, second stage. So, her own humble share the divine mission of Jesus to come. Jesus will be born and also do similar service, and she already does it before he is born. My father, the third stage is the birth of Jesus. I want to explain some details here, which I saw also in my class. Some of you may find this totally different interpretations regarding the birth of Jesus. All the things that happened to Jesus at the time of his birth, at the place of his birth, are all very significant events where Mary plays a double role. The role of your mother is to give birth to your child, or the role of your disciple who honors the child that is born. So, how did Mary respond to the supreme mystery of the Word made flesh? She was aware that something different. The person who she was carrying in the womb is not an ordinary person. The angel told her, "The Son of God will come upon you, the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and that which is born will be the Son of Most High God." All that she heard, now that God is coming, is not an ordinary child. It's a great child, a royal child. He comes in the line of David. All that she's aware. So he is about to be born, and they're going to Bethlehem. And now it will be part of the discipleship to receive this child, to honor this child. So Luke gives a very simple message, and it says, "And she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn." The four ideas here. She gave birth to her firstborn son, their mother. She wrapped him in swaddling cloths. She wrapped him in swaddling cloths. She laid him in a manger. There was no place for them in the inn. As I told you, my fathers, these four themes make up this whole mystery of Jesus' birth, the mystery of Mary being a mother and at the same time a disciple. What is the meaning of saying you are the firstborn son? Did she have a secondborn, thirdborn? Not at all. Some people even say that there are other children. That their cousins are also called brothers and sisters, like the normal religious, you know. That's quite natural. That's how our village tradition. Similarly, also among the Jewish people, even cousins that call brothers, nephews that call also brothers, and so on, things like that. So, here, what is the first one here? How did this idea emerge? Ever since God took out the Egyptians, killed the firstborn as a punishment that he was not allowed the Israelites to work away from there, and with the whole Egypt was really languishing in fright when the firstborn was killed. Ever since then, the firstborn of the people of Israel became something sacred. Exodus chapter 11 speaks of this story of the firstborn. So the firstborn became sacred, firstborn became important, firstborn became the most important child. If there are 10 children, firstborn is the most important. Because God saved you by giving the firstborn in Egypt. But the king, now he would be attacked, the firstborn was killed. And maybe the symbolic idea, God punished people in order to help his own people of Israel. And so they responded to God, thanked God by giving the firstborn as a very special child. That's why Jesus was born. He was called Jesus was born, the firstborn. He became considerably important in the Jewish tradition. So Luke's reference to Mary, to Jesus and Mary's firstborn, should be understood with the traditional background. So Jesus was firstborn, and as such, he had a special honor. He's the firstborn of the whole creation, says St. Paul. They listen to the firstborn of the whole creation in a symbolic way. He is firstborn in a particular family, and he has got some honor and glory. And Mary accepts him as the firstborn child, and is going to usher the kingdom of God to the whole human race. Thus, the very birth of the child, Mary's role in the kingdom mission is initiated. So, just like Egyptian kingdom was outcast and the new kingdom was born, when they escaped from Egypt, they were to be new people of God, and the firstborn became a saint of this new dimension. So also the birth of Jesus as the firstborn is going to be a new dimension in the life of the whole world. That's the meaning of the firstborn. Now coming to another important idea, this firstborn child was wrapped in swaddling cloths. That is the theme which is most misunderstood, I would say. What is this swaddling cloths? My dear fathers, swaddling cloths, long understood as some sort of rags which are used to cover the child because of the cold. Some rags, kandai purigal, used to take. They are not kandai purigal. If you read good dictionary in English, swaddling cloth was supposed to be a long piece of cloth used only in royal families to wrap a child with a child is born. Long piece of cloth, wrap the child, and the child will grow happily, grow very contentedly when it is wrapped in swaddling cloths. Long piece of cloth. So, the child to be born is welcomed by Mary the swaddling cloth means, as a disciple, I welcome you as a royal child, son of the Most High God. Swaddling cloths. You know, in Bangalore there is a congregation, many Babina sisters. They Babina means, you know, Babina is a child of Jesus. You go to any of the conference, you will see Mary as a baby wrapped in a white piece of cloth. Because Mary also is from the royal family of David. First time, I saw the child Jesus wrapped in a white piece of cloth. The statue of child Jesus was in Jerusalem. There is a basilica of Saint Anna. And there I saw a small statue of baby Jesus wrapped in a long piece of cloth. I asked our guide, what's the meaning of that? They only explained to me the meaning of swaddling cloths. I went and looked into the some good commentary. There they said, you know, swaddling cloths were symbols of royalty, symbols of divinity. And so Mary did not wrap him any piece of cloth, any rag, but she had already prepared with her. The child is to be born, the mother is ready with the sushant. Welcome for the child, she wrapped him in swaddling cloths to show that she has accepted him as a royal child and the son of the Most High God. And it would be this firstborn son of Mary who will soon fear better being a royal child. Swaddling cloths put around the child will have a totally royal connotation. It was a long piece of cloth. And you know how you know that? The book of wisdom speaks of Solomon, who was also a royal child, who speaks about his birth. In Wisdom chapter 7, verse 3 to 5, we have this beautiful statement. Wisdom chapter 7, verse 3 to 5. Solomon says, and when I was born, I began to breathe the common air. I was nursed with care and swaddling cloths. This very word is used to Jesus much more than a mother. Tonight, tell everybody in the world, we have a royal looking pot here. That's why the fathers, instead of celebrate Christmas and have this pudding, simply that people understand the child here is wrapped in swaddling cloth because it's a royal child. The last Muslim can't say, I'm going to go to the pudding, and tell them, it's a royal child, is what the Bible also tells us. And then the next idea is, a devoted mother was expecting a baby, should have kept this swaddling cloth ready in her. And she placed the child in the manger. What is this manger? You see, Jesus was born in a small little cave perhaps. This cave would be a good pattern if you say small cave there. The cave was meant to keep the household animals. It's part of the house, part of the family. Like in our own villages and so on. But the head is part of the house. They are only right. The animals are born. So many mothers, it is said, I was born in a hotel, and we live on the hotel, you see. I was born on a holy Saturday. My mother had bags of work and so on. She'd go to church at the time, church first morning, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock. I was born there, along with the animals and so on. And we put the jacket and actually the jacket. So she laid out there I was born. So when I wrote to my father, when I went to Bethlehem and I saw all these things, I wrote to my father, and the Bone is from the Bath and told Bone, now for another day, he wanted that talent to go again. Yeah, I'm not going to go again. It's really true. So, my fathers, what is the meaning of putting the child in the manger? Manger is the place of nourishment for all the animals. Manger is the place where they keep some grass, some water. Animals stay, come, stay to the manger. And they don't look at anybody except coming to the manger. In fact, Isaiah chapter 1, verse 2 to 3 has got this beautiful expression regarding the manger. He says it like this: Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for God has spoken. Sons have I bred and brought up, but they have rebelled against me. Now comes the beautiful expression. The ox knows its owner, and the ass its master's crib, master's manger. But Israel does not know me, my people does not understand me. Amen to Sunna Nadarna. Martha Tiryam the Nesanana Yadandri. கழுதைக்கு தெரியும் தனக்கு தீயும் இருக்குதென்று என் மக்களுக்கு எனக்கு தெரியாது. I heard this and then this was teaching the Latin some years ago. So, what is the meaning of manger here? Why did they put the child in the manger as a symbolic expression? Some people think she put the child in the manger so that the warmth or the breath of the animals can follow the child, not like that. The symbolic action is year after. The real nourishment for the whole world is this child. Just as the manger is the place of nourishment for all the animals, just as the manger is the place where all the animals come flocking, so also hereafter this child will be the symbol of nourishment. That's why later Jesus would say, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. You who eats me will live forever. He spoke about himself. About the Eucharist. So, this bread of life is already symbolized by putting the child in the manger, a place of food, a place of nourishment for the animals. Hereafter, he is going to be a place of nourishment. So, as a disciple, she makes known a beautiful idea about Jesus Christ as the future nourishment for the whole world. Even those miracles he performed, five thousand people ate. And he spoke also in chapter 6 of John, long discussion about I am the bread of life, who comes to me, eats me, will live forever, and so on. So this theme of Jesus being a nourishment, today we spoke about the Samaritan woman. After getting the message of Jesus, she went to have told everybody, come and see, he will be Messiah. So I then really get the role of being a disciple of Jesus, proclaiming his future qualities by putting him in the manger. This is the fourth type, third idea, putting in a manger, and I put like this. Here the role of Mary as the disciple of Jesus offering him to the world is indirectly evident. Prophet Isaiah makes happy reference to the animals who eagerly seek their master's manger. Prophet denounces the people of Israel who keep themselves against of God. Isaiah chapter 1, 2 to 3. So we saw these three symbols of birth of Jesus. He was the firstborn, a symbolic gesture. He is highly accepted in Jewish society. He was wrapped in swaddling cloths, a royal child, a divine child, accepted by the best of disciples and his own mother. Placed in the manger, who is already proclaiming Jesus as the future Messiah for the whole world. And finally, my father, Rayappa, he said, there was no place for them to eat, that's why he was born in the stable of Bethlehem. In Tamil translation, it comes first, in English comes last. So there was no place for the inn. Why was there no place for the inn? After he is the Son of God. Could not God see to it that some good room was preserved in the inn? There are the inns here and there. Satyam Raven Satarana, Indra, not like our hotels today. But Satarana, I don't know about that, otherwise, we can all night they come to one there. Just for a night, stay for a night. So, is there an imagery in the fact that he was not finding a place in the inn, but he had looked for a place somewhere near some family which has a little outhouse, a little cave where they can accommodate themselves for a longer time? So, the idea is this, my father, there certainly is a very, very beautiful meaning. Why he was not born in Eden? What's the meaning here? So, Prophet Jeremiah already said, you know, who goes to live in Eden? Only people who pass and stay for the night and go away. They stay for the night and go away. A wayfarer, a traveler, travels, goes to Eden, stays for the night, and then goes away in the morning. Jesus has come to live with us. Not only one night or two nights, he has come to live with us forever. And that's why he cannot be born in any. So, Jeremiah chapter 14, verse 8 to 9, that is a beautiful expression. Jeremiah chapter 14, verse 8 to 9, it says like this: O thou hope of Israel, it saved in time of trouble, why should thou be like a stranger in the land, like a wayfarer? Who turns aside to tarry for a night? Why should thou be like a man confused? You know that somebody was come to tarry for a night and go away. Emmanuel, God with us, we have to be forever. That's why Joseph and Mary, they a beautiful goal of disciples, both of them, by not putting the child in the inn, though there is no place, not having a place was quite significant. They look for a place near a home, and home is more permanent. Stable was more permanent. Animals staying there was more permanent. Manger is more permanent. And so he was born in a manger, in a stable, where there are people around, and more permanent than an inn. So, it would be most appropriate if this hope of Israel, fully realized in the person of Jesus, the Messiah, that we born in an inn, which is the place of an overnight residence for strangers and all wayfarers. Not overnight residence, just overnight and go. No, you must be born in a stable. That's a matter of what place. That's a matter. Animals are there. Animals are also part of our society. Human beings are there by the sign. He's born there. And he's going to be fully in the world, in this society, in this humanity, in this nature. Among animals, he is going to be fully there. That's the meaning of he is not being born in him, but he was born in a stable of Bethlehem. So, my dear friends, Jesus, Word became flesh, has come to dwell with the humanity. His birth in a stable in close affinity with their human habitation is certainly more fitting for him than an inn. Here again, Mary, along with certainly more fitting for him than Mary, along with Joseph, played the role of a disciple, not only in Jesus' birth, indirectly projecting his status as the one who came to live amidst humanity for a long, long period of time. That is the third stage of her journey of faith, the birth of Jesus, the role she played, especially giving birth to the child, the firstborn child, placing him in the manger, and also before that, wrapping his swaddling clothes. All these are symbolic expressions of how Mary played the role of a mother as well as a perfect disciple of Jesus. Now, my dear father, the fourth dimension of her discipleship, the journey of discipleship, is how she responded to Jesus, especially in his infancy. When Jesus was born in a stable in Bethlehem, what was Mary's response besides quietly wrapping in swaddling cloths and putting him in a manger? What was her response? It is said that Mary kept all these things, pondering them in her heart. What things? When Jesus was born, the angels came singing, glory to God in the highest and peace to the men of goodwill. And she must have also heard the angels singing. The heaven is happy that a big project has now come to begin, namely the Son of the Most High God is born as a human being. Angels are expressing their joy. In contrast to angels, humble shepherds, they also came rushing after hearing the message of the angel. They come and give their own honor and worship to God. So, the contrast between angels and the shepherds, that means the whole world is there to accept him. And then, of course, later on, the three wise men also from the east. That comes into later when Matthew's gospel speaks about it, not Mark's gospel, not Luke's gospel. What was the response of Mary? Maybe Joseph also was there. Her response was, Jesus was born and she attended his birth with meaningful enthusiasm. She begins to see and respond to the birth of Jesus in deep interiority. Not telling everybody, she kept everything pondering in her heart. So that is the contemplative dimension of a disciple. A disciple does not speak much. The disciple does. Here also Mary as a disciple of Jesus did many things. He did, for example, go to the incident to be helpful to her, a disciple. She wrapped Jesus' body in cloths, a disciple. She put him in a manger as a disciple. She gave birth in a stable and not in the inn as a disciple. Now, as a disciple, he interiorizes whatever has happened. Interiority is an excellent aspect of discipleship, the most important aspect. We also, as disciples, we spend some time for silent reflection, silent prayer. Maybe that is most absent, perhaps, in our active ministry. We are all actively involved by ministry. We have some time silently to reflect upon the mystery that we are handling, like the Eucharist, like the parish community. So, we should have time for silent reflection, silent response. So, Mary's response was really a wordless silence. It was her heart in inexplicable joy and unfathomable anticipation which responded like an earnest disciple. And after this, the infancy follows. They take the child to the temple of Jerusalem, as required by the Jewish law, The parents of Jesus were no doubt quite conscious of their religious affiliations. The first visit was to the temple of Jerusalem, where they meet two prophetic personalities, Simeon and Anna. Simeon has a lot of things to say. Simeon joyfully announced the future mission of the Messianic infant presented by name. He recognized him as the future Messiah, a light for the revelation of the Gentiles, the glory of the people of Israel. Such glad tidings from Simeon certainly brought great contentment to Mary. Definitely Mary was very happy, because she was very happy that the prophet has said about Jesus as a revelation to Gentiles. But he also said certain things which had really perhaps pained Mary. Jesus would be a sign of contradiction. There are a lot of opposites for his life. And a sword would pierce thy own soul. A sword would pierce you also. That is the first sort of prophetic dimension is what made it close to another aspect of our life. She has to suffer for Jesus. And the response was totally silence. She didn't say anything at all. She accepted all that was told about Jesus as a revelation to Gentiles, as one who brings salvation to the people, but you also cooperate with him, a sword will pierce thy own heart. Again, another visit to the same temple when Jesus reached the age of 12. What happened there? Jesus reached what is called a certain age, Bar Mitzvah. As I told you, the Jewish and people grew up a certain age, they listened to the Mishnah, they proclaimed the Mishnah. Jesus reached an age that he could understand the word of God, also explain the word of God. And to show that he was explaining the word of God, he was there with the teachers of law, the temple. And the whole crowd came and left and so on. He was not bothered about the crowd. He was there beginning his mission. Mission of proclaiming the word of God. He was talking to the Jewish scholars, and Mary and Joseph kept the place. Only they discovered his absence, and they go there. First time Mary speaks to Jesus, "Son, why have you done this?" So a disciple gives a normal question to the future master, her own son, "Why have you done this? You are my son, you are our son." And then he says, he gives a larger dimension of his whole life. Not know that I should be about my father's business. That means I have a larger life, I have a larger vocation, larger mission. Don't you know that I should be about my father's business? With that, she did not speak at all. The next thing he did, they all went home and he grew up. And once again, he said that his mother kept all these things in her heart. Again, a contemplative dimension. So, twice this occurs. The infancy phase of the time he was born, she kept everything in her heart. Again, when he was 12 years of age, after manifesting a bit of his own future mission, he comes home and leads in obedience to his son, to Mary and Joseph, and she kept everything, whatever he spoke, whatever he was, whatever he did, she kept everything in her heart. So many fathers, here comes again the silent response of Mary. After the event surrounding the birth of Jesus, she gave herself a mode of silence and contemplation. She gets back to the same mode of silence after what had taken place in the temple of Jerusalem and Jesus' own claim about the Father's house. So we see here today four stages of the disciples. So told you the first stage, the stage of acceptance. A difficult project. You have to be a mother, at the same time a virgin. It's not a very welcome sort of a situation. It's not been heard that a virgin gave birth to a child, but he gave enough signs and symbols as to how it can happen. She accepted. some things, but I accept because it is your Lord. That's how she started the discipleship. And then a disciple is manifested in an act of what commitment to humanity. Service to your needy person, how would that sensible? And then comes the important stage of a discipleship, getting the child into the world. And the first born child, wrapped in swaddling cloths, as I told you, she welcomes the child with all the royalty that belongs to the child, with all the divinity that is part of the child, and then puts him in a manger, already giving the picture role of the child as one who will give food to the whole world, as to the whole world. And then she also makes the people understand he was born in this table because he has not been given this permanently and not born in it as a passing wayfarer. And finally, also the role of silent response to whatever he said, whatever he was. She kept everything in her heart. Twice said by Luke's Gospel, once at the very time of the birth of Jesus, she kept everything, all things in her heart. There was a lot of noise around, people singing, angels singing, and shepherds singing, and so on. But as for herself, she kept all these things in her heart. Once again, she kept these things in her heart, and he manifested with his own future vision, speaking to the leaders of the church, leaders to many people, the congregation of the word of God, all that happened, but she kept everything in her heart. So many fathers, Mary's journey continues. The next three stages will be given more enlightening, the way she cooperated with the mission of Jesus, the way she became a real agent for the church, the way she became an agent for the whole world. We'll see in this afternoon. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be
forever. Amen. Lord, without time.
Video. Video.